Hey everyone, I'm Steve Lewis, and today we're going to talk about Coenzyme Q10 deficiency. As with any presentation, you're probably wondering why should I care, so we're going to start off explaining that. CoQ10 deficiency is a rare condition. It comes in a couple of forms, primary and secondary. The primary form is a defect on the biosynthesis of CoQ10, directly caused by gene mutations in the CoQ10 genes, and I'll explain more about that later. It is an autosomal recessive disease where the phenotypic effects present at an early age, often at infancy, but it's important to note that these patients can live into adulthood with the condition, and that's very unfortunate, especially given the symptoms of the disease, and we'll talk more about that later. The secondary CoQ10 deficiency is caused by indirect gene mutations that affect CoQ10 biosynthesis and also indirect mutations to the biosynthetic pathway, or indirect effectors of the biosynthetic pathway as well. One of those being statins, the class of drugs that helps regulate cholesterol levels, affect the biosynthesis of CoQ10. So we'll talk more about that later. Also, CoQ10 deficiency can appear in adulthood, but there's no molecular genetic basis for that. It just shows up most oftentimes due to old age. And mitochondrial myopathy is the most common system that you'll see, and it's managed reasonably well with CoQ10 supplementation. Again, keep in mind, this is only in adults or patients affected in a secondary way, not a primary way. But CoQ10 supplementation really isn't amazing, and we'll talk about that later in the presentation as well. It's important to note also that CoQ10 plays a role in beta oxidation of fatty acids and also in maintaining the optimum pH of lysosomes. But most of all, in order to really fully understand the clinical implications of CoQ10 deficiency, it's important to understand its role in the electron transport chain. So you'll remember that in the electron transport chain, electrons flow through the four major complexes made up of multiple proteins before ultimately generating ATP. CoQ10 is found in this yellow inner membrane of the mitochondria where it serves as an electron transporter. And the other electron transporter is cytochrome C. CoQ10 basically moves electrons down the electron transport chain from multiprotein complex 1 to multiprotein complex 3. And it's important to note that at this point where it does that, it's in its reduced form known as ubiquinol. And we'll talk about that on the next slide. So in moving those electrons, it also moves two protons from complex 1 to complex 3, and complex 3 will release these protons in the inner membrane space. And you'll notice also that ubiquinone moves protons from complex 2 to complex 3 in a similar fashion. The whole point of the electron transport chain is to really create a concentration gradient of protons in the intermembrane space of the mitochondria, where ultimately this electrochemical gradient, this proton gradient, will move the hydrogens through ATP synthase back into the matrix of the mitochondrion, which will ultimately generate ATP. So basically the ATP synthase here has two domains where this lower domain rotates and generates ATP as hydrogens move through the intermembrane portion of the ATP synthase. Hopefully you remember that from our presentation on ATP synthase earlier in the year. So yeah, it's a pretty cool complex. It's a pretty cool process, and CoQ10 is really, really important to that. So CoQ10 is a really fascinating molecule because it's a biocarrier that exists in both fully oxidized and fully reduced states. Basically, just hangs out and moves between the multiprotein complexes. On multiprotein complex 3, that is this one right here, there's actually a cycle called the Q cycle, where the oxidation of the ubiquinol molecule will release the two protons into the intermembrane space, and this will ultimately cause a reduction of another ubiquinone to ubiquinol, which is stored in a pool for use whenever it's needed. So in summary, in simple terms, CoQ10 is a biocarrier of electrons found in the inner mitochondrial membrane. It plays a critical role in the production of ATP, and it exists in three states. As far as the biosynthetic pathway is concerned, CoQ10, I like chemistry, so I think it's important to note that it has a benzoquinone structure with a decaprenyl side chain. So again, here's the benzoquinone structure and the decaprenyl side chain. And the quinone ring actually comes from tyrosine or phenylalanine. And then the side chain comes via the what's called the mevalinate pathway, which will contribute to cholesterol and dolichol, which helps with production of hormones and cellular aging and brain function. So you can see ultimately ferencyl P will contribute to the contribute its isoprenoid side chain to the benzoquinone structure and ultimately form ubiquinone. Like I mentioned before, statins are used to lower cholesterol levels, which can reduce risk for cardiovascular disease. But unfortunately, the use of statins may result in a decrease in CoQ10 expression because it inhibits the HMG-CoA reductase enzyme, which ultimately stymies mevalinate production and ultimately ferencyl PP production. And that would be a problem because, like I was saying, it would stop the isoprenoid side chain from attaching to the benzoquinone structure and ultimately making ubiquinone. So, the phenotypic presentation, now that you know the biosynthetic pathway, in primary CoQ10 deficiency, it's cerebellar and multisystemic ataxia, which is the lack of voluntary coordination of muscle movements. And researchers know that these are caused by mutations in what are called the ubiquinone genes, and here are a few of them. And then secondary CoQ10 deficiency is caused by indirect mutations that affect ubiquinone synthesis. And again, they're characterized similarly, heart, face, and skin conditions, delayed development, and or intellectual disability. And then myopathy, which is the lack of function in muscles. So it's been found that CoQ10 biosynthesis requires at least 15 genes. So diving a little bit deeper, symptoms of CoQ10 deficiency, there's something called MELAS syndrome, depending on how you want to pronounce it, which stands for mitochondrial encephalomyopathy, lactic acidosis, and stroke-like episodes. So mitochondrial encephalomyopathy is the dysfunction of mitochondrial DNA, and it affects the brain and nervous system, and it results in seizures and an altered mental state like loss of cognitive function or mental retardation. Lactic acidosis increases the blood, the acidity of the blood, decreases the pH, which will lead to fatigue, vomiting, abdominal pain, and difficulty breathing. And again, there's also stroke-like episodes as well. So it's important to note that the gold standard for diagnosis is the HPLC measurement of CoQ10 in skeletal muscle biopsy. Plasma levels are not a reliable source for diagnosis. And encephalopathy and steroid-resistant nephrotic syndrome are most common manifestations, and that can lead to renal failure as well. Let's talk about treatment options. So for primary CoQ10 deficiency, unfortunately, more research is required. There's not really a grand benefit. There's not really a grand benefit to using CoQ10 supplements. It has been found that if you do take CoQ10 supplements with primary CoQ10 deficiency. It helps in some patients, but in most times it doesn't. And when it does help, it's pretty negligible. And then for adults with statin-related CoQ10 deficiency, they can basically eat healthier, exercise, and ultimately stop their statin use, or they can supplement it with CoQ10, which has been found to help increase the bioavailability of CoQ10 in the mitochondrial matrix of those specific patients. But again, it's not incredible. So let's talk about why that is. So one of the reasons that secondary CoQ10 deficiencies can be created is by multiple acyl-CoA dehydrogenase deficiency, which basically, it's not a universal feature of the disorder because some patients with that MADD, present with normal CoQ10 levels. So that wasn't really a reliable source for as a cause of all CoQ10 deficiency. And again, some patients with primary and secondary types do show positive signs with CoQ10 supplementation. So it's really hard to get a grasp on how to treat this disease that presents in so many ways and affects and treatment is affecting patients in such different ways. It's important to note that CoQ10, like you saw, is a pretty lipophilic molecule. And that's really interesting to me because it would be taken up by cell plasma membranes and other cellular membranes before ever reaching the mitochondria. So here in this photo, we've got mitochondria, right? The outer membrane, the inner membrane, and then the matrix. If you were to supplement with CoQ10, it would never, more than likely, not get down into the mitochondria because it would be, it's lipophilic. It would get stuck in the other cell membranes. Again, because it's lipophilic, it also poses a problem with the CNS, the central nervous system, and the blood-brain barrier because it can't really cross that in any useful fashion. So I think a great next step for research would be to design a drug that specifically targets the mitochondrial inner membrane, which will be very difficult to do, but that's the point of molecular targeting research. Because you got to get the CoQ10 here in the inner membrane. So I've come up with a potential design. It's a little out there, but I like to dream big. I think that this is where medicine is heading, and I think it's the future, this particular molecular targeting ideas. So this is how I'm thinking about it right now. Basically, I think it would be great to design a Trojan horse that delivers CoQ10 directly to the inner membrane of the mitochondrion. So you'll hopefully recognize this from your advanced cell biology book. And basically, what I envision is attaching CoQ10 molecules to a pre-protein that can diffuse through a cell. So let's pretend the cell's out here. It would diffuse through the cell and then directly target the outer membrane of the mitochondria via the matrix targeting sequence. And then there would also be a mitochondrial matrix targeting sequence. So the Trojan horse would pass through, a TOM complex and then attach to the TIM complex, where a protein would ultimately be released. So in this example, it showed that heme folded up here. I'm suggesting, why don't we attach like a ubiquinone that could be released with the triggering of attachment of the intermembrane space targeting sequence to the inner membrane. So the design of this drug would basically be that as the protein is folded up, it releases ubiquinone in the inner membrane space, which would be detached from the folded protein. And hopefully the proximity to the electron transport chain complexes would help it diffuse into the inner membrane due to the binding site affinities of complex 3, let's say. So that's kind of my, really excited future looking idea. I'm sure I'll learn more about the possibilities for targeting this Trojan horse drug during advanced cell bio too, but that's pretty much what I've come up with so far. I think it's a really exciting time to be looking into this, and there's so many possibilities with ubiquinone as a biomolecule, because we know so much about the mitochondria and the different membranes and the different targeting sequences of the mitochondria. And it would be great if in the future, within the next few years or few decades, we can find a way to help these poor patients with CoQ10 deficiencies by bringing ubiquinone directly targeted to their inner mitochondrial membranes. So here are my sources. Again, I'm Steve Lewis, and thanks for taking the time to learn about CoQ10 deficiency with me. Hope you've enjoyed the presentation, and I hope you have a great day. Thanks.